Good morning. Good morning, everybody. When I walk into my 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock class, they don't even have the lights on. I'm not sure whether they are there. I go in and switch on the lights expecting students. They are there. So, well, thank you very much for coming all the way. I want to recognize some people who came from Fort Hays State University. Please stand up. And who came from Seward County Community College, all the way. Can you stand up, please? And I'm going to recognize everybody who came from all the other places, including Pitt State. But they came from far, okay? And thank you very much. Where's Kobe? Okay, thank you, yeah. Who did I miss from far away? Did I miss anybody from far away? We had somebody else from farther than his, but he dropped at the last minute. He had something else, right? But anyways, thank you very much for coming. Who is new to this conference? Raise your hands if this is the first time. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20. About 50. Can you guess my profession? There were 101 attending last night. I'm a statistician. And today is the World Statistics Day, I heard. But anyways, thank you for coming. This conference has been going for a long time. There will be a talk about that. I'm not going to take her place here. This is first time we host at Pitt State ever. And I want you to learn something and take it back and do something about it, you know. Do the right thing. That's all I'm asking you, okay? Nothing much. So this conference, we started planning this a year ago, and the next year's conference, we started it yesterday. We started planning it yesterday. So I want to invite my co-chair, Rita Rose, to come here and introduce our statewide planning committee. I'm going to step aside.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Good morning. I'm so glad to see you all here this morning. We had a fabulous evening for those of you who were with us last night, and we're very glad to be back with you. Before I introduce our statewide committee, one little quick housekeeping. If you're trying to log into our Wi-Fi, we had to change the password last minute. You know how technology is. So it's a capital T, Tilford, exclamation point. Exclamation point because we're very excited to have you here, right? All right, thank you. So very quick, the statewide planning committee, and would you please stand when I read your name? Susan Bradley from Butler. Jeff is not with us today, but Jeff Toomey. Marla Darby from Emporia State. Cheryl Lisday from Emporia State. Catherine McGonigal, Fort Hays State University. Star Trisconia from Johnson County Community College. Brandon Clark from Kansas State University. Myra Gordon from Kansas State University. Madai Rivera from Kansas State University. Michelle White-Godinette from Kansas State University, E. Nathan Thomas III from KU, Mike Worley from KU Med Center, Jill Allen from Pittsburgh State, Dr. J from PSU, myself, Dr. Lee Young from PSU, Patricia Dahl from Washburn University, Miguel Gonzalez-Abuelas from Washburn University, Jean Griffith from Wichita State University, and Alicia Sanchez from Wichita State University. Please give them all a round of applause.
Thanks, Dietra. Okay, I'm going to introduce the local planning committee, the on-site planning committee. So these people worked really hard to get this thing running, and the statewide committee did their part. Let me recognize, it's in the back. Jill Allen, standing back there, She's our manager, pretty much, you know, running the operation and keeping track of expenses. Jeff Burns, our computer consultant, here. Jay Hodges, I don't see Jay, is he here? He's one of our marketing people who did lots of computer work for us. Gregor Carlin is traveling internationally, he's not here. He's another marketing person who helped us with all the computer work. And Dita Rose, you saw her here. Lee Young is sitting back there. He is pretty much the boss of all this support to us. So, and then the other name, Ananda Jayavardhana, I can pronounce it very well. Lots of people don't do that, but I can do it. Okay, what we are going to do is we are going to start the program, and if we have enough time left before the keynote, we'll take a little break, okay? So I'm going to introduce somebody who has been to this conference many times, you know. He was a student in my department a long time ago, which I don't remember. I wasn't here. And he was a faculty member, a chair, a dean, and then the vice president, and now he's the president of our university. And I think he went to the conference with me three times, 2007, 2008, 2009. And before that, he has been there many times. He doesn't remember. So he is a big supporter of diversity activities. During his time as the provost and the president, we actually created the Office of Student Diversity, which was not there. We hired a director, assistant director, staff and services. So then testament to his help to these efforts. And he's always helpful. If you need anything, you talk to him. He's very supportive. He's our ninth president of the state. Please welcome Dr. Stephen Scott.
Well, good morning. It almost sounded like he said I was in his class. Did you think that? That's kind of what I thought. I preceded him a little bit in the math department. What a great job he does. Ananda, thank you. And Dietra, thank you both. Great job getting this organized. And you've already seen, you saw it last night, you heard it from Dr. Olson as she welcomed you to the campus, but we like to have people come see us. We really do. And so we roll out the red carpet regularly when people come and want to have the experience of Pittsburgh State University, want to be on our campus, and we produce great weather when we have guests. And Jeff, is that IT? Or I'm not sure who takes care of that. You're working on that. But what a beautiful day it is to be on a campus anywhere. And certainly we're glad you're on the campus of Pittsburgh State University and getting to experience what we get to experience every single day. You know, you might see some of the Pitt State people sitting in this room looking around, really kind of looking like they'd never been in the room before, and it's possible they've never been in this room before. This facility opened on August 19th. So we've added 31,000 square feet of additional meeting space. These ballrooms are brand new. The ballrooms we had before would seat 300 or 400. This will seat about 650 people at round tables for a dinner or banquet. Downstairs, we have some beautiful space for our student body leaders and our activity councils that work to develop programming for our students. There's great space downstairs. So I hope as you're here today, I know those of you last night who were at the Bicknell Family Center for the Arts had a chance to see that beautiful facility. And it has a purpose, certainly. But I hope you have a chance today to wander through this building and see what this building is about, because it really is the living room of the campus where our students hang out, recharge their iPhones, most importantly, recharge their bodies by getting something to eat, and just visit and have a great time. You see faculty hanging out here and just staff, and it's just been a great addition to the campus. And we're excited that while you're here, you get to experience that and you get to be a part of this. So very excited about that particular piece of this conference, that you're one of the first conferences to be here. That's pretty neat. Last night, I thought President Martin did a terrific job. What passion she has for diversity. Her life's journey certainly represents many aspects of what we all want to see as we build greater diversity and greater understanding of cultures and diverse students, faculty, and staff on our campuses. And And I think that I did sit there and think, she's preaching to the believers. I know that about you. I do know that. But it doesn't matter, because you need to hear that periodically. You need to have that message reinforced. We all do. And to hear that once again and feel that passion that Dr. Martin brought to the podium last night. And I thought it was powerful. And she's a great colleague of mine, a good friend of mine. And we were pleased to see her on the campus. But I thought that was a terrific way to start this conference. So again, to the planning committee, great job, a great selection. So as you go through the day, I know you've got some really nice breakout sessions planned. I hope you enjoy those, but also, just like Ananda said, this is about learning. This is about taking something away that you can try on your campus, new energy, new ideas, new programmatic pieces that you could put into place to make your campus better. And we're certainly working to do that on the campus of Pittsburgh State. So hope you have a great time here on the campus, a really beneficial experience. And then we look forward to seeing you back. Dietra, is this right?
Yeah.
Next year, we get it 2 years in a row. So that is awesome. We'll look forward to seeing you then. Have a great day. Thank you. I had one more duty. And because this duty relates to my bosses in Topeka, I better take care of it. But it is my pleasure to introduce the Vice President for Academic Affairs of the Kansas Board of Regents, Dr. Gary Alexander. Gary, we're glad you're here.
Thank you, President Scott. I am here to bring greetings and thanks on behalf of the Kansas Board of Regents. I think I can tell you, on behalf of the board, we're most impressed that this is a campus-driven event that expresses the imperative to provide education to all who desire it and all who need it. And that was very eloquently articulated by President Martin last evening. We all know this is easier said than done. You do hard but important work, and you're not told that enough. Your presence here gives voice to your school's efforts to address issues of diversity and multiculturalism, and we appreciate that beyond what you know. So beyond greetings, I want to offer my thanks and the board's thanks for your effort, your commitment to keep the memory of Dr. Michael Tilford and his pioneering work alive. This is significant. As our nation struggles to understand itself in the context of an increasingly diverse culture, your work becomes all the more critical. So thank you again, and have a great and productive day. And my job is to introduce Dr. Cheryl Lidsey, who is Associate Professor of Communication and Theater at Emporia State University and an esteemed member of your planning committee. I didn't time that well.
I didn't walk fast enough. It's my job this morning to tell you a story. Our story is about Michael Tilford and about the history of the Tilford Conference. So it's a little bit about a storyline about Michael Tilford and a little bit about the storyline about where we came from. As far back as 1988, the Kansas Board of Regents had a statewide committee investigating the recruitment and retention of students. And in 1994, Kansas Board of Regents, through the Council of Chief Academic Officers, created what was then called the Kansas Regents Conference on Diversity and Multiculturalism. According to our member back then, Joe Bast of the KU Med Center, he was a Tilford Conference representative from 1994 to 2011. He shared with Ananda that Michael Tilford was the conscience of the planning committee back then. Every time the committee strayed from the original goals or lost track, Michael would sit very quietly and then make a sage comment and refocus the discussion. He really knew what this conference meant. The first two conferences, way back then, were in 1994 and 1995, were held at K-State and KU, and then in 96 they went to K-State was at 1994 and 95, and then we went to KU for 2 years. After that first, the first two, and then after the 3 weeks after the KU's conference, Dr. Tilford passed away. And the decision by the Kansas Board of Regents and the Chief Academic Council of Chief Academic Officers, I'm going to call him Coco now, they decided that they would rename the conference in honor of Michael Tilford. Now, a little bit more about Michael Tilford. He was born in 1936. That would be about the time my parents were born. He had four siblings. They were raised by a widowed mother in rural Oklahoma during the Great Depression. He graduated from Langston University in 1957 with a bachelor's degree in mathematics and chemistry. A year later, he went to Johns Hopkins and earned a Master of Teaching in Science Education. And then he went to teach at Wichita West High School for several years. He received a Ford grant for advanced graduate study to complete an EdD at Oklahoma State University, which he completed in 1970. Beginning that year, Dr. Tilford began serving at Wichita State University in many different roles. He was a faculty member, an assistant dean of the graduate school from 74 to 88, and then he was the dean of the graduate school from 88 to 94. And then his last role at Wichita State was the Associate Vice President for Academic Affairs from 94 until his death in 96. At the 2007 conference, Joe Bass said, Peter Soller, professor of English at Wichita State, said, Michael Tilford was an avid golfer. A friend of Zoller said, who was Linwood Sexton, a former regent and close friend of Michael's, Michael couldn't even see the flag for the hole they were playing. He took a shot, but couldn't find his ball anywhere leading to the green. He looked, and he finally, finding another golfer, it went into the hole, said. Michael treasured his hole-in-one as a tribute to his prowess as a golfer. Dr. Zoller further said, I quote, in a world that grows increasingly shrill and uncivil, Michael Tilford exemplified the good that can be done by lowering one's voice, being civil and courteous, and looking for sensible solutions to problems, even if those problems may take time to resolve. If I go back to 97, the newly named conference back then was held in WSU, which was in, and then went to Washburn, hosted in 98. In 99, each university organized their own conference, and the keynote was broadcast over ITV. Everybody remember ITV? It was a pain in the butt. Yes, sir. KU Med Center hosted the conference in 2000. The conference was suspended in 2001. In 2002 and 2003, the conference took a different route, and it happened, and it was open only to the chairs. It was held as a joint conference between the Tilford Conference and Kansas Regents Academic Chairs Committee, which was KRACC or KRAC. KU hosted the conference in 2004, and there are no records for the conference in 2005. In 2006, I'm not sure what happened. Back in 2007 and 2008, 2007 is when I came on board and Ananda came on board, and this is when we joined the planning committee, and so that was when we were at Wichita State. We know that in 7 and 8, it was at Wichita State. 9 and 10, it was at KU. K-State had it for 11 and 12. And as you know, Emporia State had it for 13 and 14. We're here at Pitt State for 15 and 16. And my understanding is that Fort Hays State is planning to have it in 2017, unless things change.
Nothing's going to change.
Oh, whoo! All right.
According to our new program.
Exciting news. All right. So that is the history and a little bit about Michael Tilford. We have about 10 minutes before I'm going to introduce and we're going to talk about Dr. Allen. So if you'd like 10 minutes to quickly put your clean your tables, finish your eating, and then we will begin with the keynote address. So enjoy your food. Dr. Allen is currently the Associate Vice Chancellor for Diversity and Inclusion at the University of Colorado at Denver and the Anschutz Medical Campus, where she serves as a master's mentor of the Tenure Track Faculty Mentoring Program. She is also a professor of communication. That's my discipline, which I'm very proud of. Her research and scholarship focuses on organizational communication, social identity, diversity in higher education, and critical pedagogy. Among her numerous publications is a groundbreaking book entitled Difference Matters, Communicating Social Identity. This is the second edition, which was published in 2011, which I use in my classes, which I'll be using next semester, and I'm very excited about it. And you can all go online and buy your own copy. Dr. Allen was recruited from Howard University to the University of Colorado in 1989 as an assistant professor. Since then, she has been promoted to full professor. She has served as a department chair and an associate dean. She assumed her role as chief diversity officer in August of 2012. In addition to performing her duties at the University of Colorado, she presents keynote speeches and conducts workshops and consultations on a wide range of topics, including, this is long, self-empowerment, recruiting and retaining diverse faculty, diversity, strategic planning, transforming curricula, unconscious bias, inclusive pedagogy, mentoring, fostering an inclusive campus climate, presentational speaking, empowered leadership, creating respectful workplaces, and teamwork. She has received numerous awards, and I'm going to give you a few of those, one of which I had the privilege of giving her back in 2004. The one in 2004 was given by the National Communication Association Women's Caucus, which was the Francine Merritt Award. She also received the National Communication Association Carol C. Arnold Distinguished Leadership Award, both of which are really exciting. That's not the right word, but we'll use it. The Western Communication Association Master Teacher Award, the University of Colorado at Boulder Gay, Lesbian, Bisexual, Transgendered and Allies Annual Ally of the Year Award, University of Colorado at Denver two awards, the Annual Award for Outstanding Achievement for Commitment to Diversity, and the Inaugural Award for Excellence in Faculty Mentoring. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Brenda Allen to the 2015 Michael Tilford Conference on Diversity and Multiculturalism as she presents Difference Matters and Pedagogy.
I do all that. Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
Isn't this a fabulous morning?
Yes.
Yeah, it's fabulous in terms of the weather. It's fabulous in terms of all of the things that any of us might be doing. This is what we're doing. And how wonderful is that? What a privilege it is to be able to take time to think and talk and feel and process with one another in terms of diversity and inclusion in higher education. I want to express my gratitude first and foremost to the planning committee and to everyone who has put this phenomenal experience together. Please join me. We can't applaud them enough. I'd also like to thank all of your leaders, the provost, regent, president, et cetera, in terms of your commitment to diversity and inclusion and your support of events like this. Without leadership supporting us, we cannot make the progress that is imperative that we do. So thank you all very much. Let's give them a round. Before I begin, I'd like to know who is in the room. Any students in the room? As I look back here, raise your hands. Hello, students. Let's greet the students. Without whom, right? Without students. How many staff administrators are in the room? Okay. Staff, yay, give it up. Faculty members, raise your hands. Yes, faculty. Community members. Any other categories I may have missed? Excellent. Well, good morning. Are you ready? Están listos? Is that correct? Are you ready? Okay. Sont prêts? That's French, in case you didn't recognize. So, I only halfway teasing in terms of recognizing that we all come to this space with a variety of ways that we do indeed communicate. And how important that is, it actually speaks to the fundamental theme of difference matters and pedagogy. So, I want to start, before I tell you a bit more about what we're going to cover today, with a couple of stories. As you heard, I was recruited to the University of Colorado Boulder from Howard University in 1989. And part of why I chose to do that was I was excited at the opportunity it presented me professionally. And at that time, my major and my area of focus was computer-mediated communication. I was concluding at a non-traditional age, that is to say older, my dissertation at Howard as a full-time employee who also had the benefit of being able to take classes. And I'd gotten my master's there, so I said, okay, my mother did not raise a fool, and so I took advantage of the fact that I could earn my PhD by virtue of being an employee. So in that regard, I was also teaching, I was doing the Beltway teaching kind of thing, so I was patching together a living by lecturing here, instructing here, et cetera. And so I got a full-time position as a lecturer at Howard in teaching a course called Computers and Society. And by virtue of that, as I said, I was able to take some classes in my, I got my master's in organizational communication. So, fast forward, I'm completing my dissertation research because I was able to get a venue to do my dissertation research when I was teaching at a Northern Virginia Community College. I actually asked one of those classes, because they all worked. I said, I need a place to do a dissertation project. Can anybody help me? And a young woman said, well, I work for the head of IT at PBS, and I bet he would let you do some work there. So I said, okay. I went, and this person was so receptive to me. I ended up doing my dissertation research on a new technology they were adopting at PBS at that time. That was computer-mediated communication. And what I did was I looked to see, does a culture of an organization correspond with how they adopt a new technology? That new technology was, wait for it, electronic mail. So I was concluding that research and invited to Boulder to consider being hired to teach in that capacity. I went there, I taught in that capacity for maybe a year because I was so amazed and fascinated by dynamics related to identity, including assumptions people made about me. For one, my hire was deemed a twofer. Anyone know what that is? They got two for one, right? Because I'm colored and curved, black and female, all right? You like that, don't you? And so, and I was also highly qualified. And they were very excited to bring in a scholar who is doing that cutting-edge research on computers and communication. But I got fascinated by assumptions people made about me, and here's where we're now really getting into the heart of the talk today. Difference matters in pedagogy, right? Difference matters in ways we do teaching and learning, all of us, and ways that our identities are related to those experiences of teaching and learning. So one example would be that the contracting office for the university called me and said, we really need to get many minority subcontractors. Can you connect us with someone? I just moved here. We don't know all one another, right? Now, I say that in that way with a slight sense of humor, but also with empathy. And that's what's important to understand about so many of the ways that we can feel frustrated in moments of communicating across difference, that most of us are doing the best that we can do. And it's through education that all of us can do even better than our current best that we can do. And so that's part of why I was excited to change, and now this has become my era of scholarship. I'm very pleased at the accolades and the opportunities I've gotten in my discipline. I've had phenomenal mentoring, and I'm very pleased to be here. So, two stories. One, and these both are from my time as a faculty member at CU Boulder. I was in my office, and a student named Carol Garcia, who Carol and I think kind of bonded because she was also a non-traditional student, and she was an undergraduate, completing her undergraduate degree in communication. I had gotten a flyer, and the flyer was written in Spanish. So when Carol came to my office, I said, Carol, what does this say? And she looked at me, and I could tell she was a little upset, not necessarily at me. She said, Dr. Allen, I don't speak or read Spanish. And I said, really? And she said, yes, really. Because her generation, I think she was second generation Colorado, and she said that her generation, her family, yes, they spoke Spanish at home, but they intentionally did not let their children learn and speak Spanish because of the stigma of that. And so that was their way of protecting them, that they were not allowed to speak Spanish. So that was an aha moment for me. And it was a moment that I later framed in the concept called TUI, thinking under the influence of dominant ways of being and thinking about others. So I assumed that just because she had a Spanish surname, she spoke Spanish. And after that, I learned that I had other assumptions about members of certain groups. That was illuminating for me because here I was, as an African American, a black person, really hoping people would understand me and the differences and so forth in my racial ethnic background. So that's story number one. Story number two is one of the classes I had the privilege of teaching that actually was fundamental to me changing into this area of research, scholarship, teaching, and activism, as well as fundamental to me recognizing the complexities of social identity. So I was getting ready to teach that course on critical thinking. We had to rotate as faculty members, taking turns teaching critical thinking. And I decided if I'm going to teach it, I want to connect it with something. I'm very action-oriented. I really, as a student myself, appreciated classes where I could readily see, how is this relevant? What can I do with this learning, with this knowledge? So I decided, given the kinds of assumptions and so forth people were having about me, as well as some of the things that the few other, especially faculty of color on that campus, as well as some of the students of color were sharing with me, that I decided why not talk about and learn about critical thinking and race. So I was in the class session where we were talking about assumptions, and I asked the class, so when you think about assumptions, how does that work? How do you ever even know that you have indeed assumed something? I pose that question to you. How do you realize you've assumed something? Right, when you find out you're wrong, when you make a mistake. So we but from the time you woke up today till you got here, you assumed a whole lot of things, and they came true, so you're not even aware of it, right? When you sat down on that chair, you assumed it was going to support you, right? So my point is that it's not until we bump up against assumptions. So we were talking about how assumptions operate in our lives and how indeed we need assumptions. We need to assume cognitively. A white male student raised his hand and he said, do you remember when I emailed you this summer? He emailed me because he was going to be in this class, and he was one of those phenomenal students. I love students who reach out to me, and I'm always responsive to them. He reached out to me to ask a bit about the course, so we exchanged some emails. So he said, we exchanged those wonderful emails, and when I got to class and saw that you were black, I was shocked. Does that make me racist, right? He assumed that I would be white, and because I wasn't, his question was, does that make me racist? What I appreciate in that moment is thinking about my various social identities, right? So my identity as a black person, I have been socialized that if someone questions why I'm in a certain role, that they are racist, right? I've been socialized to assume, well, how could they not know that, et cetera. At the same time, I have been socialized as an educator that there's no such thing as a stupid question, that it is my duty to help students understand whatever I'm trying to teach them. And in that moment, cognitively and emotionally, the educator trumped the black person, right? And it be and what I love is I can actually have the sense memory of it, that it was important for me to help him and those students process that. So I said, so let's think about this. How many of you have ever seen, how many of you have ever had a person of color, a black woman, teacher, period? Nobody raised their hands. I couldn't even raise mine, I could have raised it based on graduate school at Howard University, but it took that long before I'd even had, right, a person of color, period, as a teacher. So I said, how many of you have even seen a black woman depicted in the media, right? That was way before How to Get Away with Murder, right? And other kinds of media depictions of black women in professional roles, not to mention professors, nobody. So you get where I'm going with this. And I said, therefore, it's logical. I said, how many black women faculty do you think there are on this campus? No one knew. I said, well, they hired me and Dr. Loretta Coleman, and Dr. Polly McLean was already there, so there are three of us, right? And so it logically makes sense. So just as you would assume you sit on that chair, it's going to support you in terms of the depictions, et cetera, it made sense that he did not expect me to be a black person. All right. Now, as it unfolded and I ended up writing, this is the opening story in my book, Difference Matters, I realized I had assumed things about him as well. Right? So he was a student at CU Boulder. His name, let's say his name was Jason, because his name was Jason. So Jason, I assumed that Jason would be white. I'd assumed that he'd be male. Why did I assume he would be male? Jason is his name. Get what I'm going with this? I assumed he would be traditional college age because that's the primary group that we served that the CU Boulder served. And so when I encountered him in class, I was not surprised, okay? So my point here is that difference matters. Ways that we vary from one another in terms of our identity make a difference in the teaching and learning situation. And those differences matter for all of us. And that story actually begins us with thinking deeply and going within in terms of how these issues matter to every single one of us. So I'm going to begin by explaining what I mean by difference. I'm going to talk about how difference matters, unpacking that dual meaning, right? Matters is something significant. Matters, there are many significant issues to consider. And in doing so, I invite you to reflect upon why you are here today. As I said earlier, we're all privileged that this is how we get to spend this time and we've chosen to do it. I want you to go within your heart and your mind in terms of what are you really hoping to get from this experience? And I trust that you already got something from our phenomenal keynote last night. I trust that you've already gotten something from interacting with one another, because that's the way you learn and grow. I went to the rib crib last night with a group of the planning members and had just a fascinating conversation and fellowship, but also already I've learned some things and I have some ideas that I'm going to assign myself. So if you're not a person who tends to do this, I invite you to assign yourself that you're not going to leave here without clarity of specific actionable items, because this road to transformation, to valuing diversity, always begins with us, regardless of our role. Students, that's especially for you. I don't want you to think you have to wait until you're in a certain position to be a mentor, to be in a certain position to have input, et cetera. Some of you are already doing it. Whatever all of us are doing, I invite us to be committed and intentional about doing even more. So in terms of difference, I prefer using the word difference rather than diversity. And this is not that I'm saying diversity is not a viable and important concept, because it really is. And it is important in terms of how diversity, what we tend to mean by diversity, is that we think about members of our society who are traditionally and currently underrepresented. And we've got to be diligent in terms of that. However, I use the word difference as an invitational concept and as one that's related to the notion of inclusion. And so for me, difference refers to ways that human beings vary from one another. And that particular framing of difference is different than some theories of difference, which actually do talk about how people are different from the dominant. So I just want to be clear that when I say difference, I mean very simply ways that human beings differ from, vary from one another. And why I like that is, okay, if we have difference on this side, here's a continuum, what's on this side? Different, same, right? And of all human beings on earth, is there anyone that is exactly the same as you? No, even if you are an identical twin, not the same. Is there anyone on earth that is exactly different than you? No, because just as a human being, just start with that, right? So my point is that we're along a continuum. And it's really important to think about that for us as human beings and to think about humanity. Difference then is an important concept that as I think about how we can move forward, right? Audre Lorde, as some of you may be familiar with her, she's self-identified as Black, lesbian, mother, warrior, poet. She was a civil rights activist who studied feminist and oppression. And I appreciate her framing in terms of, it's not really our differences that divide us. What happens is sometimes we don't recognize, accept, and celebrate those differences. So this is an important framing as we think about difference, and we think about difference more specifically as social identity. And social identity is very simply one's sense of oneself based on being a member of a particular group, right? And so difference is group-oriented. It's the idea of membership that's perceived by others and or by oneself. So oftentimes I meet people who self-identify as multiracial or biracial, or people who come from, people who look at them and can't quite identify right them. And they say to me, people say to them, what are you? So that in itself, you know, shows that we've been socialized to kind of want to compartmentalize people. And we say that, it's sort of like, so what difference does it make if I say I'm, you know, Native American and African American and Scottish, right? If I said that, what difference does that necessarily make? It could make a difference in terms of if it's a genuine curiosity and a seeking to learn about one's past and so forth. And yet most of the time it seems as if it's just a sort of small talk, curiosity. So membership can be perceived by others and or by oneself. and it can be meaningful to self and or others, identifiable. We have labels. And with these labels, we act as if they're universal. We act as if they're the truth. And in actuality, we've made them all up. And we need to make them up because just like with assuming, we need to think, we need to be able to categorize and so forth. The challenge is not only do we do that, but we also ascribe value, consciously or not. And that's where the problem comes in terms of back to perhaps you can see the impact of me teaching critical thinking, that's really helped me to get in touch with some of these processes. So we also learn them, assign them, teach them to one another. So did you know that research shows when a baby is in the mother's womb, if they find out the baby's sex, they actually begin to interact with the baby differently even before the baby is born. So the baby then is born, and we learned, Judith Butler, perhaps you've heard this, says gender is not something we have, it's something that we do, something that we perform. And we're taught, we're scripted about how to perform that, how to costume ourselves, how to behave and so forth. We teach each other how to do that, right? And so it's learned and it's assigned. And again, we need to do that to organize our lives, to be able to interact somewhat effectively and humanely. The challenge is that it's laden with power dynamics. It's laden with dynamics of whose notions, for instance, of masculinity, whose notions of femininity do we tend to value? Do we have expectations about in society at large and also in our various endeavors? So going back to this notion of difference matters in teaching and learning, another experience I had at CU Boulder was we had an opportunity as faculty members to go to our Faculty Teaching Excellence Program to try to improve our teaching. And at that time, and actually my sense is even now, whether or not a faculty member has actually been taught to teach varies. Is that true still? Yeah, okay. So students, did you know that? That some of us have actually been taught to teach and groomed and given feedback and so forth. Others is sort of like, okay, you'll be teaching these two sections of blah, 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 right? And by the way, many of us do quite well without that, but I'm that one that wants to learn and grow and get better. So when I got there and found that I could do this, even though I had a history as I think I told you, I was kind of a Beltway instructor. So I was teaching voice and diction at Northern Virginia Community College. I was teaching public speaking at Howard. I was teaching Pascal one summer at Trinity. Yeah, what was that about? Did you? That I took it to another level in terms of si me puedo, right? Someone said, I want you to come teach teachers Pascal, and because I had taught, so some of you now, I'm doing this kind of thing for people in the room who can relate, right? That in teaching and learning, it's okay to do a few things where maybe only a few people get the reference, but you want to contextualize it. So Pascal was a computer language. I was teaching BASIC in my computer literacy course that I mentioned to you before, right? And in that, BASIC was pretty simple, and it's logic, whatever. So somebody knew that I taught BASIC. They said, we're going to do a two-week training for teachers at Trinity, and we want to teach them Pascal. Woo! And, So I was like up all night, every night, teaching myself and then trying to share with them. What was my point there? It's like, okay, taking it too far in terms of making a living, quite frankly. So I was patching together a living by teaching in a variety of places. And that's how I really gained some insight and guidance in terms of working with a variety of people. So anyway, this idea of difference in social identity is laden with power dynamics that we need to be aware of how they influence and affect what we do. And for all of those categories of identity that we all might speak to as we encounter one another in situations of teaching and learning, we often rely on how we've been taught to value or not value, how a hierarchy we have about individuals. And as you heard from Dr. Lindsay, one of the things that I do work on is unconscious bias. And all of us are likely to do that thinking under the influence. all of us are likely to engage with people. So the example I was trying to get to in terms of when I got to Boulder, in the Faculty Teaching and Excellence Program, one of the things that they talked about was gender bias in the classroom. And I thought it was amazing that they were saying some teachers or faculty members will respond to females in the class differently than they respond to males. And the ways they responded to males actually validated and reinforced males more than they did with females. So I said, well, that's fascinating. I don't do that. Then I said, okay, think about it. Are you willing, Brenda J, that's what I call one of my many pet names for myself. Brenda J, why don't you check yourself out? So I checked myself out. The next class that I taught. Now, here's what's amazing. I'm checking myself out. I'm aware, right, that these kinds of things happen. I'm on kind of autopilot teaching, and guess what? They in the article about that, they should have my picture, you know, as role model for here's how people engage in gender dynamics, right? And at that time, I was a budding feminist, but I was extremely guilty of those behaviors. Now, where did I get those behaviors from? Anybody? Where do you think I learned to engage in that way? Society? My teachers? Yes. So you get my point here, and it comes back to the phenomenal role we have in education, that what we're doing and how we're doing it, whether we are intentionally saying this thing and unintentionally doing that thing, right? That unintentional is more likely to be received, especially when the unintentional corresponds with all of the other ways we're all being socialized, through the media, through our families, through religion, et cetera, et cetera. And most of those, however, I contend, are not intentionally set up to say, I'm grooming you to be sexist, right? This is not intentional. Otherwise, I wouldn't be doing this work. The hope is in helping all of us to get clarity about how we're enacting these kinds of ways of being with one another. So that's difference equals social identity. When I have time with groups, I actually invite them to, I invite you in this moment, and maybe it's something you can think about later if you haven't done it. If I said to you, you have an opportunity to introduce yourself to a stranger, the stranger will not know your name. I'm not going to tell the stranger your name. Why would I say I won't tell the stranger your name in terms of that person knowing something about you? That is exactly right. They'll start forming an impression of who you are. Perhaps have you heard of the resume research? Where, and I don't know if you know, but that some of that was done in the early 2000s. There one came out last year. The resume research, for those of you who aren't familiar, is where researchers send out thousands, they send out lots of, that's pretty specific, isn't it, Dr. Che? They send out a whole bunch of resumes, and they vary the resumes only by one thing. So they've done some where they vary only in terms of a female-sounding name and a male-sounding name, or a black-sounding name and a white-sounding name. So for instance, Deshaun Jefferson or Cody Smith. So that's the only thing that's different. And time after time after time, in terms of a request for an interview, a request for whatever, will be statistically significant more responses to the white over the black, the male over the female. And the researchers contend, it's back to the earlier point, that this is not because all of those people are actually seeing those names and saying, no, I'm not gonna hire that person. It's more about ways, again, that we've been socialized. So my point here is that I wouldn't tell them your name because of that. People may assume that they know something about you, positive, negative, neutral, whatever. And you will only be able to give me three social identity categories. So if you think about that definition of social identity, I suspect that you could give a whole lot of labels, right, of who you are. Just how I asked today, student, that's a social identity. faculty, staff, administrator. All of those are social identities. And all of those are identities that we've been scripted to enact. So we kind of know how to be a student. However, how we know how to be a student varies. And we as faculty may assume that how they know how to be students is how we knew how to be students. And that's just not always the case. So I digress only slightly. Three labels. How readily could you decide on what those labels are? I wouldn't tell you the context, because if I told you the context, right, like why I'm introducing you, what do you think that would do? Yeah, that's right. that would actually prompt you in terms of what information about me do I think is relevant, right, for a love connection? Or what information do I think is relevant to get hired doing such and such a job? So not just a job, but a particular job, right? What do I think I need to highlight? So I'm intentional in saying I'm not giving you the context. So think about that just for a moment. What would your three be? And then when I have time again with groups, I'd not only say, what would your three be? I'd ask you, how do you know that about yourself, right? Where did that come from for you, that that's how you identify? I would say, if I saw you on the street, would I be able to tell whatever that is about you? And if I could tell, what would be the cues? How, if at all, have you been taught to enact whatever that is? So this always is fascinating in terms of the kinds of things that emerge, and I have people share with one another. And this kind of sharing begins to open up people to realize ways that we vary as well as ways that we're very similar. So sometimes what happens is two people who may look, who do look, not may, so I take the two of you, who look different in terms of the visible cues, the two of you have this kind of conversation, you may discover, for instance, that one of the things you put down is parent. And that within that, there are some things very similar to how you enact parenthood and where you got that from, et cetera. You see where I'm going with this? And what happens in debriefing is, and I also ask, have you ever felt that you have particular privilege? We're going to talk about privilege this afternoon. Have you ever thought that you have particular privilege because of any of those identities? And most of the times, people can't identify those as much as the second question. Have you ever felt that someone was somehow discriminating against you because of any of these aspects of identity? So pretty fascinating results occur with this, including that more likely than not, people who are members of non-dominant groups will give one of those labels. So in terms of race, more often people of color will indicate race and white people will not. But the more I'm doing this work, the more I find that white people are indicating their race. And to me, it's in some ways a good thing because it's helping in terms of the processes that I'm using in this work is to invite all of us to know that we are gendered, raced, classed, have sexual orientation, et cetera. And we're all, you know, we're all kind of animated by that. So in terms of traditional masculinity, I would suspect that many of those of you who identify as men in the room can very much talk about what it means to be a man, and you know, sometimes what it means to be a real man and how you have to enact that, right? So that's a bit about social identity. If I want you to think about that question, I usually conclude it by saying, yeah, and so how did you feel about limiting yourself to three when in actuality you could list a whole lot? I also ask, when you meet a new person, what do you kind of pick up about them? Or do you stop to think, wow, this is a richly complex human being just as I am, who, however, may be likely to endure particular ways that people assume about them? So you're not denying the very key kind of notion of race, gender, class, et cetera. They do matter, but there's so much more to it. So that's a bit quickly about difference and social identity. So these issues matter for a lot of different reasons. How am I doing on time? Ten. I have until 11. Yes. Thank you all so much for giving me time to really engage you, and you seem engaged, and I appreciate that. So matters, right? Matters refers to something is significant. So I want you to think for a moment about, with that definition of social identity, how do you think that matters in higher education? And in fact, I'd like to hear from three people. How do you think difference, which is social identity, ways people differ from one another, how does that matter?
Well, people bring different experiences to the table. Mm-hmm. So when you bring a group of people together, everyone's not going to think the same way mm-hmm. about how to solve a problem mm-hmm. or how to work that out. Mm-hmm. So that's a big tangible piece of how it matters.
Yes, that is excellent. Because it's really speaks to teaching and learning. And what's important is, as our speaker told us last night, when you have situations of that kind of diversity, right, that you can have so many positive outcomes. The challenge, however, is it's got to be a climate in which people feel that ways they differ actually do matter. Otherwise, right, often in our quest for diversity, you know, we want to acquire. So it's sort of like when I got hired, well, with you we got a twofer, right? You could check that off. Well, what do we do with that? On the downtown campus that I serve, we love to say our campus is very diverse. With that I say, okay, what you specifically mean is we have over 55% undergraduate students of domestic racial ethnic diversity, right? Underrepresented, the new majority, right? So that's what you mean by that, first of all, so clarify. Second, so what, right? So what if we have that many students of color on our campus? What, if anything, are we doing about that? How are we optimizing it? What are we assuming those students are doing because they have that rich variety among themselves? So difference matters in that regard. Thank you so much. Another reason why difference matters. Yes?
Expectations.
Mm-hmm. So say a bit more about that.
Well, what people want from whatever venue they're attending, conference, mm-hmm. class, mm-hmm. they expect something mm-hmm. that may be very different from
mm-hmm.
each other.
Also,
and their needs are really different.
Yes, also excellent point. And I hope you see what I'm saying is these issues matter not just for students, they matter for all of us. And in fact, that's how we better serve our students when we become more aware of and proactive around these notions, right? So our expectations can make a difference in terms of who we are and why we're there and how we want to do what we want to do. Thank you. One more.
Commonality.
Say more.
Even though with all of the differences and mm-hmm. the different
yes.
How can we learn the same?
Yes.
In what ways can we bring solutions to larger groups of people?
Yes.
Where can we find that we're really the same? Yes, mm-hmm. we're human and we need shelter that's durable and to feed more people and take care of more people. Mm-hmm. How are we more the same?
Excellent point. And indeed, that gets back to the difference, similar in the continuum. And that's a way when we recognize that and look to see how are we similar that within those differences, right, back to even what I said may happen if the two of you talk. Thank you all very much. So those are important reasons why difference matters. Difference matters also because, as you know, all of the kind of population projections, specifically in the United States, they're calling it the Browning of America. And thinking about, perhaps you know that, I guess it was 2 years ago, and if the trend has continued, that more babies of color are being born than white children. And that's really important because it does not lead to what sometimes people may assume, right? They may assume, okay, so now we have over 50%, right, of our population, but for us in higher education, let's say the children who were born this month, right, 18, 19 years from now, then when they would be eligible by virtue of age to attend a higher education, those percentages are not going to stay the same on their own. So in higher education, we need to be thoughtful about how, if at all, we're reaching back to ensure that we even have the kind of pool of students we may want. But though that's the main thing that's often invoked, but you all are probably aware there are other kinds of things related to population and changes in our society that matter, which include persons with disabilities, starting with students themselves, who from K-12 now, much more mainstreaming, et cetera, than we used to do. And so many of those students, thank goodness, are now aspiring to also go to university. Moreover, we, in terms of medicine and medical advances of diagnosing persons with learning disabilities, et cetera, and striving to have them in our classes. And you have the intersection in terms of persons in the military who aspire to come back to school and sometimes also have trauma and are dealing with stress in ways that we may not even realize that they are. And those are just a few of the kinds of things. In terms of societal changes, increasing in terms of various civil rights. So certainly gender identity and sexual orientation are two key aspects along those lines. We also have many more persons who are older coming and intending to go to college, and persons who will want to change their careers. So there's lots of things in terms of these different ways that we vary from one another that matter, and yet the inequities persist. And I won't regale you with those. I trust with this group you have some sense of them, but I encourage you as you go forward that you continue to get clarity about those inequities, because it can be easy to have a sense that, you know, we are making progress, but there's much more progress to make. The very good news is that there's a potential for positive change when we actively think and feel about ways that human beings vary from one another. But there's lots of challenges. And the challenges include denial, that some people want to say, we are good. We're in a post-racial society. Who really believes that, right? But I think people do. People will point to beautiful exemplars to say that means we're good, right? Because you have this person in that role, we now have our first blah, 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 and all of those are indeed very important. But when you start looking at all of the numbers and percentages with the various groups about which we're talking, we really, really need to work better than we are. We also, in terms of thinking about difference in social identity, we tend to simplify those categories. So take, for example, race. Amazing to me is oftentimes conversations about race still seem to be mainly about black and white. And even with that black and white, and by the way, this is not a criticism, it's an observation in terms of how that may prevent us from a rich conversations and rich kind of strategizing, especially because more and more persons themselves are not necessarily limiting their definition of their race and ethnicity to one category, but we tend to simplify. Gender is another one that we tend to use binary categories, and yet we've moved forward in that regard. And these challenges, by the way, when you think about the challenges, I trust that you're always already seeing them. How do we meet those challenges, especially when we think about pedagogy? We tend, in terms of difference, to focus on the other, with the other meaning not the dominant. And here's where, especially on our college campuses, we are doing ourselves and our students a disservice, because in that quest to include those who have been excluded, we may be neglecting those who expect and anticipate they're going to be included. So back to my point about, well, so what, that we have this high percentage of students of color, how are we getting, in terms of racial diversity, all of those students to engage with one another, to want to learn from one another, to see themselves as prospective colleagues and classmates? You heard that one of the campuses I oversee is a medical campus, and that one is really crucial, that all of those students, they're aspiring professionals going into the same kind of area. If they don't see themselves as peers and see themselves as valuable resources, we're probably just going to perpetuate status quo, right, in terms of dominant or non-dominant. We also too frequently think of difference or diversity as a problem, and not necessarily as, hey, there's this problem to solve, right? Because problem solving can indeed be exciting and engaging, but it's more like, oh, what are we going to do about this problem? And so imagine what that feels like to persons who are the focus of that so-called problem. to kind of be viewed as you and your people are a problem we've got to fix, we've got to resolve somehow. And finally, a challenge is we tend to see diversity. That's the issue over here. Just like there's diversity, there's technology, there's this, there's, you know, as opposed to diversity, but actually I feel the same way about technology, that that's something that we should be infusing in what we do in the educational endeavor. So those are some concerns in terms of challenges in general, but more specifically, why difference matters in higher education. We are a place where we're helping our students to really become who they are or who they want to be, because it's a site where they're going to encounter, many of them, much more difference than they've encountered anywhere else in their lives. Because unfortunately, in my opinion, we remain in the United States a pretty segregated society in terms of the kinds of places where people go to school, where they worship, if they worship, where they do recreational activities and so forth. So your experience may not align with that, right? Your experience may be, oh, I have lots of different kinds of friends and experiences, but please believe me that for the most part, we remain pretty segregated in terms of things like race and social class and religion, et cetera. So because we are a place increasingly where students will be encountering those kinds of differences, what an opportunity we have, right? In terms of many of our campuses have a goal to prepare our students to engage in an increasingly multicultural world. Anybody have something like that as part of your diversity intention? Raise your hand if you do. The intention is to help prepare students to be in a multicultural world. No? Okay, all right, good. So with that, we need to be much more thoughtful, engaged, and heartfelt, but how are we making that happen? Because higher education is indeed a context for change. And yet, on top of the challenges that I mentioned earlier, oh my goodness, higher education, we have other challenges, including that we tend to track diversity by the numbers. And so just counting how many of them, whatever the them may be, we have, how many more do we want, how many, et cetera. Again, I'm not saying we should not do that. I'm saying, however, if that's the main way we're trying to understand with diversity, we are remiss. Moreover, when we do diversity by the numbers, too often, we are limited in terms of the kind of data we can even gather. So do any of your campuses have an optional item where students who are applying can indicate their sexual identity? Anyone doing that yet? No. So that's happening in a few campuses, and not without controversy. Not only controversy in terms of people who just believe that we shouldn't care about and count that, but controversy from those of us who are allies and concerned about, well, what do you really do with that kind of data, right? So a challenge is finding, you know, having data to track what we mean by diversity. But another challenge is that we don't disaggregate it as much as we can. So for example, sometimes we will have numbers that say we have X percentage of minority or underrepresented, then I wanna see those disaggregated. And also see those disaggregated by department, by whatever. So I'm pleased that I was part of a project, Equity and Excellence Project out of the University of Southern California, which looks specifically at race data on campuses. It looks specifically at student performance in gateway math courses, and specifically disaggregates in terms of American Indian, Hispanic, Latino, Latina, and Black. And here's where another challenge arises for me is, in particular, usually the federal government and other entities do not tend to include Asian American underrepresented racial ethnic groups, because here again, they're missing an opportunity in terms of disaggregating that in the whole, Asian Americans may be doing well on a number of items. And yet there are certain Asian, some of you know this perhaps from where you are, there are certain Asian populations that are desperately in need. Hmong, and where I live, the Hmong population, Vietnamese. So you see what I'm saying? We neglect to really do some fine tuning in terms of this. We also often define diversity narrowly. So I alluded to this earlier, that oftentimes when I have discussions, I say, so how are you defining diversity? Because more often than not, in the situations where I find myself, people are talking about race and ethnicity. And as I said earlier, I'm not saying we should not be talking about race and ethnicity, but that's not the only category. Moreover, it's the intersections of race and ethnicity, right, with other aspects of identity that matter. It's the distinctions in terms of mixed races and ethnicities. And as I've said already, we tend to focus on other, and we relegate responsibility for diversity to particular groups, to particular departments, to particular disciplines, without thinking about how can diversity be everybody's responsibility. Moreover, how can we resource everybody so they're the responsibility? So, an example would be that thinking about what happens for underrepresented students, first generation students, for example, and I was pleased to be at a table where we were talking about the TRIO program, right? That's a phenomenal program that does excellent work on my campus and the campus for my colleague that I was with last night. And yet, that should not be just the purview of TRIO. So on my campus, a group of faculty and staff just started a first gen initiative. And they had a student parent the family night, and the other day they had ice cream, right? So for first gen students to come by and get ice cream, and they have first gen buttons for faculty and staff who are first generation. So students are often surprised when they learn you're the first in your family to go to college, right? That makes such a huge difference to their self-esteem. Some campuses, do any of your campuses do safe zone training in terms of GLBTQ identity, and then you have a little sticker that says, you know, that. So students know that when it comes to certain aspects of their identity, they don't have to check them at the door, and they just go over to, for instance, I oversee our educational opportunity programs office with Black Student Services, Latino Student Services, American Indian Student Services, and Asian American Student Services, that students know, and by the way, our EOP, all students know they're welcome there, right? And those students in particular, if they have particular needs and concerns, they know there's someone there who has a deepened understanding of their needs and their values and want to help them not only to survive but to thrive. However, it should not be limited to that, right? It shouldn't be limited to here's where I can kind of feel like I'm me and people kind of get me or they want to seem to get me. So we relegate that responsibility. In terms of our search committees, so many things that we do where we figure, and this is what happened to me when I got to Boulder. I was on so many search committees as a twofer, right? Either because they wanted my voice as a woman or my voice as a Black person. And then when they found out how awesome and humble I am, they they continued to invite me to do a lot of other things, much more than my white counterparts in the communication department. And by the way, I think this is all well-intentioned. And I have to also admit my bad in that regard, because I was socialized. I'm supposed to try to help people, right? That's part of my gender and race and my generation. I was kind of taught, you're supposed to serve people. You're supposed to help. Anybody who needs your help, you're supposed to help them. Now, in the meantime, I'm trying to get tenure. And I'm on all these committees and going to all these fabulous social events, right? Because, you know, to kind of showcase the new faculty person, et cetera. Whereas my white colleagues didn't have those kinds of responsibilities. And by the way, even if some of those white colleagues at that time had wanted to do some of that kind of work, there were persons who were members, for instance, a white male, may not have been welcomed to do it. So this is, again, all of us need to think about how we are engaging in these different kind of identity politics that's not just about dominant dominating the non-dominant. It's a reciprocal power kind of dynamic. We also tend to react rather than being proactive. So in my role as chief diversity officer, so much of my work is much more about something happened, we got to do something, as opposed to getting out in front of it, having some value, a sense of being prepared. Perhaps you know that Stephen Covey's definition of proactive is to be response able, right? So that you're prepared if something's occurring, you're in front of it, and you've got things in place that you can handle it. Finally, and this is really, really significant for our conversation and for this conference, we tend to limit diversity education to students. So on my campus, all of our undergraduates have to take at least one cultural diversity course. Is that so on your campus, something like that, some kind of requirement? Well, I think that that is important, by the way, and if you don't, I strongly encourage you to consider that. So you're guaranteed that you've given your students something, right? And the something, I would hope you have a committee that looks at what is that and how effective is it. But in terms of faculty and staff, there's nothing mandatory. The only thing that comes even close is sexual harassment training, right? And that's to be in compliance. And it's also very important, don't get me wrong, but in terms of really resourcing faculty, as well as demonstrating that these issues matter to us, very, very limited in terms of that. And also, we even, in terms about relegating responsibility and limiting diversity education, as we get into the notion of pedagogy, we tend to, teaching and learning, we tend to think that that's the domain of only certain subject areas. So I recall a faculty member in math kind of saying, well, math is just math, right? Not recognizing that there are ways in terms of teaching math that you can be very thoughtful and culturally responsive of how you do that. So those are some of the challenges. And more specifically to thinking about pedagogy or teaching and learning, methods and practice of teaching, the art and sciences, and I was reading somebody said an even craft of teaching. And with that, I think it's important to think about inclusive pedagogy. And I love this statement about inclusive pedagogy. Attitudes and behaviors which communicate to all students that you welcome them to the course. And to that I would add to the course and the campus community, because I think that teaching and learning is something we all on our campuses do. So regardless of our role, I think we should be aware that we are contributing to our students' educational experience. Whatever the mission of our institution might be, we are all really, really important in that process. So there are different factors of inclusion that I want to spend the remainder of our time talking about. And the first one is your own self-awareness and reflexivity. The second is course content, then your knowledge of your students, classroom climate, and finally your teaching behaviors and attitudes. And as the framework for this part of our time today, I think about a quote from Maya Angelou, Dr. Maya Angelou, who said something to the effect that we should think of diversity as a rich tapestry in which all of the threads are equally valuable regardless of their color. So she was referring, I think, to race. And I think as we think about that notion of rich tapestry, we can think about other facets of identity, right? That valuable regardless of those gender, race, social class, sexuality, nationality, religion, all valuable. So I'm going to think about this notion of texture as we go through each of these very briefly, with the intention being for each of them, I want you to think of, and I'll give you an opportunity to talk about how do you do that, and also what else might you do. At the conclusion of our time, I will be doing an explicit call to action. So I'd like you to, if you haven't done it already, to be thinking about what will you do differently as a result of what we've shared today. So for each of them, I'm going to say a bit about them, and then I'm going to ask some reflection questions. So in thinking about this notion of rich tapestry, and how you know, even thinking of the touch and thinking about what fabric and so forth can mean to us and what we do in higher ed. So the first one is self-awareness and reflexivity. And my questions to you in terms of self-awareness include how aware are you of your own, how your own experiences as a student, right? And students, I want you can think about this in the same way. How much are you tapping into your own experiences as a student in terms of how you serve students, whatever your role might be? So that's a reflection question. Another reflection question is, how have you experienced inclusion in your learning experience? And how at all have you experienced maybe not feeling included? Another question is, how aware are you of your embodiment, of who you, you know, your, and let's take the ones that are particularly salient for all of us, your gender and your race in particular, your gender and your race in particular. How aware are you? And also your social class, because work on first generation faculty members is pretty fascinating in terms of awareness of what that is in terms of how they engage. So how aware are you of those when you're actually in the act of teaching or serving students? So those are just a few questions to think about, your self-awareness, because your self-awareness is going to make a difference for all of those other factors of inclusion. Your self-awareness is going to and does make a difference of how you engage with your students. So I was highly aware at CU Boulder of being that black woman faculty member with those mainly white students. And yet my experience, it turns out, was different than some of the other black women and black women graduate students on that campus. And I attribute that to a few different things. One is I was older, as I told you. Another is I was in communication, as opposed to some of my colleagues who were, one colleague in particular was a Latina in business. And she really had a very, very difficult time in terms of how students responded to her and so forth. So those kinds of things make a difference. I just want to go back to how complex these issues are. And now I want to go you to think and feel about yourself. So you have a sense of those kinds of notions of self-awareness. Would you please just turn to a partner and just talk? I'm just going to give you a very brief time, but I think it's important to try to share more than just me sharing with you, to share a bit in terms of your self-awareness in whatever your role is, right, on your campus. Everyone understand the assignment? You can work with the questions I've given you of, you know, how aware are you in terms of your own social identities as you do your teaching? So I appreciate that from what the energy I'm receiving, you could readily delve into that, right? Just to begin to think about how your self-awareness matters. And I'm now going to power through each of the remaining factors. I'm going to throw out reflection questions, and I'm going to make this PowerPoint available with the actual questions, right? For you to do this work, because this is not something... Oh, yeah! I'll be here all day. And by the way, feel free to use these PowerPoints. I'm not that person who, you know, because if you find this valuable and it helps you do your job, because one of the things we're not doing as well as we can, I alluded to it earlier, is resourcing ourselves to do this well. So if this is something that resonates for you that you might feel comfortable sharing, I encourage you to do that. We're going to do the same thing today with talking about privilege. But in terms of self-awareness, here's some questions, other questions. What is your philosophy of teaching? And how does your philosophy incorporate inclusive pedagogy? What do you value about teaching and learning, and how, if at all, do you try to be certain that you incorporate that? So one of the things that I realize about myself is that no matter what I teach, what's important to me is that all of us in that classroom, by the time from day one until the class is over, everyone can point to how they've learned and grown in that class, as a result of that class. And by the way, that could be because they actually learned the subject matter. And yet, for me, it's also other kinds of things that they can point to. So if you haven't thought about that, please do. In terms of some of the things to do in terms of self-awareness is to really be mindful of yourself. to be honest and gentle with yourself, but open-minded. Back to my point about TUI, thinking under the influence, and being open to that there, you can improve your teaching along these lines. I continue to do that. I don't do much teaching. I do training a lot, and I just reflect and critique and think about what I do well, what else I could do. Learn to share authority in the classroom. Think about assumptions you may hold. It's back to even, you know, the earlier part of what might I be assuming in this interaction? What am I assuming in other aspects? What are some of your own hot buttons and biases? And for especially for those of us who are really aware of our identity, any of our identity categories being non-dominant, of ourselves being embodiments, right, that historically and currently are likely to experience discrimination, but to think complexly about how is that mattering in the classroom. I actually learned, again, I had the advantage of affiliating with our Faculty Teaching Excellence Program in conjunction with my own awakening in terms of being a feminist identified and learning about social construction and so forth. Well, I began to realize that, and I think maybe it had to do with being non-traditional in terms of being getting into higher ed in the tenure track. I think it had to do with just my upbringing, sir, as you mentioned, that in my home, my mom, of how, what she modeled, right, as a black woman, kind of modeled for me a way of being in the world. But anyway, with all of that, I realized that I was doing kind of call and response. If you're not familiar with that, it's a kind of African-American way of, it was hard for me to just, like with you all, I don't know if you can feel it, but it's hard for me to just talk, you know, be the sage on the stage. I like to be the guide on the side. I like to help people talk and process. And that's part of how I've been socialized, in particular as a black woman, which is not saying that others with, you know, you could be a white male or a white woman or Latina, right? You may have that same way that you do. I'm not saying it's limited to that, but I became aware of that. So you want to be much more aware of that. What are your own preferred ways of teaching and learning? So just as I said, I like interaction. I like putting people in groups. Some people want to have information, et cetera. So I learned to really mix it up, right? And not just do just what I wanted to do, even though I felt kind of good about, you know, and students tend to give the response that they like the way that I teach. I realized that some students also would prefer that I was very clear, that I do little lecturettes and so forth. So striving to mix it up. Those are a few in terms of self-awareness. The next is just thinking about, and this is a quote from Paulo Freire, if you're not familiar with him. He's a Brazilian philosopher and educator, really famous for critical pedagogy and talking about the banking concept of education, which was one of the first readings I did in teaching critical thinking. If you're not familiar with the banking concept, it says we just try to deposit information into students and expect them to, you know, give it back to us as opposed to problem solving and interacting and engaging. So I really appreciate his quote along those lines. The second factor of inclusion is course content. And of course, when you think about course content, they're important questions. Whose voices, perspectives, and scholarship are being represented? As important, how are those perspectives and experiences of various groups being represented? A group of graduate students in our College of Public Health, group of graduate students of color came to speak to me, one of the first things when I became chief diversity officer, because they were very upset that the only time that underrepresented racial ethnic groups were discussed in their courses was for negatives and for disparities. Now, those negatives and disparities exist. However, there are other positives and there are other kinds of ways to represent and present a variety of groups. The very good news is some of you probably already know there are lots of resources and so forth available. More than ever, we don't have to feel alone. We don't have to feel like, how do I do this? Because that's a reasonable challenge, especially for faculty who have so many demands and so many obligations of how do I begin to get this information and insight, especially when there's a kind of resistance that has to do with how my students receive this, what will my colleagues think, what if I say the wrong thing and somebody thinks I'm sexist or racist? So all of those also matter. You also want to do things like having guest speakers. And nowadays, you can have guest speakers in so many ways. I probably 3 or 4 times a semester, I Skype in somewhere. And I love it, right? Somebody who's using my book and they say, could you be a guest speaker? And I'm like, yes, indeed, right? So then, you know, in particular, some of my white colleagues who are teaching this subject matter, and what I like is more and more are, then they can have the actual author present. There are phenomenal TED Talks about a variety of kinds of issues where you can like have a guest speaker. So there are ways you can really engage in your course content in a variety of ways. You even want to think about how are you testing students. You want to think about even as you strive to diversify, you don't want to neglect, of course. And I think that's a challenge that people think, well, I can't do the canon of my discipline if I have to fold in this other information. You really can. And this is never asking to compromise quality. And in fact, it's asking to enhance quality for everyone involved. So those are some reflection questions there. And there are different things you can do. And some of you already know it. I have a couple of website links at the end, bless you, that really are, I find, are phenomenal resources for all of these issues. The next one is your knowledge of your students. And here, the questions include, what are the demographics at your institution? Because even as there are certain issues that matter internationally, what matters particularly at your institution? And what are the demographics overall when it comes to all of the categories of difference and diversity? What are they in your department? What are they in your particular classes? How do you get to know the students on your campus, in your department, in your classes? And again, I love it when I have more time because I learn even more new strategies about how in particular faculty get to know their students. So one of the things I did at Boulder, and partially for me it was because I grew kind of weary of my colleagues, most of whom were white, kind of saying, well, these students are so white, right? And I'm saying, and they're so much more than their race, right? It's sort of like they wanted to put them all together. And so for my own sake, I also wanted to be sure I knew each of these students was a unique human being. And I also wanted them to get to know me. So just as you want your students to know you, and by the way, this is not just for faculty, it's staff, et cetera, then how much of it all do they know about you? What might they be assuming versus what you're actually sharing? And so I actually, before hip hop was even like that popular, I did kind of like a little beat thing. I wish I remembered it because I know you'd want to see it, right? I'm kidding. But it was my way of kind of being playful as well as acknowledging that for me as a black person, right, that genre, that way of expression matters to me. And by the way, that doesn't mean everybody else black felt the same way, but I did that. And then I said to students, so tell me about yourself in whatever way you would like. So they did things like collages, a eulogy, an obituary, seriously, students are so creative. One student, however, did a mixtape. Now, this is really dating it. For those of you who don't know, there's a thing called a cassette tape. So this white male student did a cassette tape, and I popped it in my car, because I rolled like that. And that he has such an eclectic collection of music, most of which I also liked. So that for me became, okay, I was saying we need to recognize that all our students are different and so forth, but when they did it, I realized I was so surprised. I was like, wow, they really are different. So, you know, what are ways that you get to know your students? And there are lots of ways to do it. And I know that you all are doing things. And it's important that the more you share, and also the more you incorporate similar kinds of things within your units and departments, students grow to expect it. It's serving them, you know, it's preparing them. It's helping to optimize that they're engaging with one another right here, right now, not only as well as preparing them as they go forward. The next one is the classroom climate. And when I have time, I even play with that notion of what do we even mean by climate? You know, is it chilly? Is it too hot in here? You know, how are we trying to make it? And climate is challenging when you think about that, because different people have different sorts of sensibilities and sensitivities. So none of this is going to be easy. None of it is easy, even as if you think about it and feel about it. And I find that people respond to, if you genuinely seem to be trying to address it, if you genuinely seem to want to understand, you know, what works for you, how can I, it's sort of like a hospitality mentality. So with classroom climate, the idea is, for one, how, if at all, do you strive to establish a climate in your classroom? If you had to do a metaphor of what your class is like, or an analogy, what would it be? Mine is learning community. And in that learning community, we are all there to help one another to learn and to grow. And I am the lead learner, right? So, and I actually model for students. I have to look for, if they say or do something that I learned, I let them know. Wow, I hadn't thought about it in that way. Thank you, right? And I have guidelines for interacting as community members that students, and now I'm using it, I'm actually adopting it for search committees, which I love. For those of you who are faculty aspiring administrators, it's not really the dark side. It doesn't have to be seen as that way. And we can provide so much in service to that. And I'm loving being able to transfer my skills in that regard. So think about, for example, what would it mean to have a classroom as a learning community? What would it mean if you don't already? And I neglected to share with you that I'm not at all, in offering everything I'm sharing with you, I'm not at all saying that you're not already doing these and doing them extremely well. I would just rather not err on the side of sharing something with you that I find exciting and valuable than to leave it out. And in fact, if indeed we have that in common, it just goes to show that great minds do think alike. So things to do then are model learning as a lead learner, support student success, involve students in evaluating their learning, solicit their feedback on the climate. Oftentimes what we ask students about is more about their learning, right? And we need to do that. But how about this meta-communication and having them? One of the things I started doing is not only sharing with students my philosophy of learning, I asked them to share their my philosophy of teaching. I asked them to share their philosophy of learning. And students said, no one has ever asked me that before, right? To just think about, what is learning about for you? How do you engage it? Why are you doing it? How you intend? And so, you know, taking the time, and some people hesitate because they say, all of this I'm trying to teach. Well, for you to really teach well, I think it's worth some of the time that this may take. And especially if you can unite in a unit to say you're going to do similar kinds of things, is one of my challenges was I stood out. And not just because of my fabulous height, but because of, and not just because of my race and gender, but become some of my styles of teaching. I stood out in my department, and then there were a couple of others, though, who were somewhat similar, and the more we agreed and began to do this work, then it really made a phenomenal difference. Final one is your behaviors and your attitudes when it comes to teaching. Now, you've probably seen that all of these can overlap, and I hope you've seen, for those of you who are staff, and also for those of you who are students, these are the kinds of things that you should expect. Right? And that you should, for any faculty, any experiences you're having where that's occurring, be sure you give that feedback to those faculty members. And in any way that you might be able to support faculty of helping them understand these issues, I encourage you to feel empowered that you, you know, the fact that, for especially those for whom you were sent here, or someone, you know, is supporting you, that this is a way you can demonstrate that you value it, that you can take some of this knowledge and information with you in that regard. So attitudes and behaviors include, how do you attend to your own behaviors? How conscientious are you? It's back to that reflexivity. How open are you to realizing that you may indeed be unconsciously biased? But also, how much are you really attuned to what you do well? So this is as much about identifying and valuing what you do well, as well as places where you might be excited about improvement. So I'm continuing to learn and to grow in terms of especially teaching and training, and especially because I have the privilege of coming to talk with groups like you, then that keeps me really on my toes of learning more and more and being open to. It's challenging for those of us in higher education, I think, because in some way we've been singled out as being smart and the best and the brightest, and sometimes it feels as if we kind of think, okay, we're done, right? We've learned and we're now good to go. One of my identities would be lifelong learner, and really taking that not only seriously, but with some sort of joy and a sense of, wow, you know, this is a sacred kind of profession that I'm in, and I get to make a difference. And I continue to learn so many things. I'm learning more about gender identity and transgender. I'm learning more especially about international students and identities, and learning the kinds of stereotypes and assumptions that I have about people that surely come from the media, come from limited exposure and experience, even though, you know, I think I know some things, but I'm just thoughtful and I stay in touch with myself and I seek out those opportunities to learn and to grow. And I do it in a variety of ways. So those are some things in terms of thinking about your attitudes and behaviors. In particular, I encourage you around thinking about students from underrepresented groups. And for all your students, you should have high expectations. But you should couple them with doing everything you can to ensure they will succeed. So I would tell students, I'm going to do my part, and you just have to do yours, right? And you want to think about, well, back to assumptions and your behaviors and attitudes. How many of you were, when you were in college, you would go see your faculty members in office hours? Anybody? Okay. A lot of us did not, right? I did not. I shouldn't have raised my hand. It's just a monologue for you, right? So you may assume because you have office hours, the students will come and they will seek your help and so forth. For many of us, going to see the faculty member meant you were in trouble, right? It's like going to the principal's office or whatever. So we bring different kinds of approaches. And so especially when I went from the Boulder campus to the downtown campus, I got in touch with those kinds of things. And I'll talk more about that this afternoon in terms of recognizing some of the privileged statuses some of us have about how we engage in the world we may assume our students do. So what I started doing was I had a very simple assignment which said you had to come and talk with me about your paper idea. So it wasn't like something hard and it had to be right or wrong, so they could come to my office and see, oh my gosh, she is so mean and evil, I'm never going back. No, they could come and see, you know, and I would be overly solicitous, quite frankly, to welcome them, whatever their ideas were, so, you know, to kind of demystify that process. So at any rate, my point is you want to think about, there's a lot of things you want to think about. To wrap it up now, these are just some recommendations to think about, and as I said, I'll make these available. Deepen your commitment to difference matters. Focus on these factors of inclusion. Identify and implement promising practices, and there's so many of them. Develop and reward inclusion standards. Identify, create, and share resources. And again, there's so many of them. How many of you have some kind of teaching excellence or faculty program on your campuses? Some of those I found can improve by incorporating these issues more into the service they provide, and that is on us as faculty and staff to encourage and invite that and resource it if it is the case, so that it doesn't seem limited back to, again, certain persons and roles on our campuses. Collaborate with faculty, students, and staff. Now, this is extremely important in terms of most of our campuses have phenomenal student access, student support services, and oftentimes they're siloed in terms of academic affairs and student affairs. And yet, my goodness, the way that all of us can inform what all of us do is amazing. And I love being in my role. As I said, I oversee our Educational Opportunity Programs office. And because I'm a professor and I have been on that campus, I have relationships with different faculty and departments, and we are doing some really exciting things of forging those partnerships in service of, again, all of our students. And as I said, many of you may be doing that, but there may be more that you can do. Engage in professional development. And those of you who are responsible for funding and helping faculty, staff, and students acquire these resources, I encourage you to make that investment. Your return on investment will just be phenomenal. In terms of another issue I neglected to address, which is so much of our focus on diversity and inclusion on our campuses is rightly pointed to our students, that we neglect to also think about how are we making our workplace, for those of us who work together, how are we really helping make that climate inclusive and supportive and valuable? So that, back to the earlier point, when you are in a team, when you are striving to do whatever you're doing together, if you're really valued, right, that you are able to maximize innovation. You're able to maximize how do people feel their morale. You're able to maximize, quite frankly, recruiting and retaining additional members of underrepresented groups. Because word gets out in terms of whether or not someone would want to work in a particular place. So those are some important issues that I encourage you to think about. This quote, I think, it kind of captures what I want you most to take from this in terms of thinking about teaching and learning. And John Cotton Dana, in case you're not familiar with him, was a public librarian, and he was extremely committed to having public access to libraries and access to the stacks. I don't know if you know that early in librarian, you know, the history of libraries, that really only certain people could have access. So I commend that this is what he is known for, and I especially appreciate his quote. And these are some of the resources that I mentioned to you earlier, and those will be available. And in conclusion, I close with a quote from Gloria Anzaldúa, self-identified Chicana Tijuana cultural theorist, poet, writer, activist, and lesbian, who says, and I say to you in terms of difference matters and pedagogy, and thinking about pedagogy as teaching and learning, all of us, regardless of our role on our campuses, that is part of why we are there. And the way we do it, the way forward, is starting with ourselves. And as she says, and I'll say it, and let's say it together, I change myself, I change the world. Thank you.